then you say, when you get in there, if you're called for jury duty, they're going to try to eliminate you from the jury if they realize that you're a nonconformist or that you can think for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say this language, all the language that I use is designed to get to the point as quickly as possible.
Mm.
If people ask me what I am, I'm a jury rights activist.
Okay, everybody, I'm here today with Jake Witmer, who is a very interesting gentleman. He has a lot of really excellent ideas and some excellent experience on the topic of jury independence, jury independence activism, and just in general on the whole strategy of achieving a more libertarian society. How are you today, Jake?
I'm great. Thank you, George.
Glad to hear it. So for those of our listeners who aren't familiar with you and your work, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, for the previous 12 years, I ran around the country putting the Libertarian Party on the ballot,
mm-hmm.
going into different states and getting the required number of signatures to place the various libertarian state slates on the ballot in all the different states, occasionally working in individual specific districts to put legislative candidates on the ballot.
Mm-hmm.
And in the course of that time, in the back of my mind was always the pamphlet that I had read many years ago from the International Society for Individual Liberty, two pamphlets actually, that are some of the best written pamphlets on jury rights.
Mm-hmm.
That are out there. And, one of the pamphlets is A History of Jury Nullification, and that's Larry Dodge and Don Dewick. I wrote both of these pamphlets, and the second one is New Hope for Freedom, I believe it's called.
Mm-hmm.
Jury Nullification, New Hope for Freedom. So those two pamphlets, which are still available at isil.org, although they've now put them behind a username and password wall, which is not smart because they broke about 1,000 or so links of mine that I'd put out there, maybe more than that, to their to the URLs. Anyway, those are some of the best things that I had ever read about jury rights. They answered my initial questions about why don't people just try to protect their freedom through the court system?
Mm-hmm.
You know, why is the court system not a good avenue for protecting individual freedom? So these were questions that I had when I first started to work for the Libertarian Party.
Mm-hmm.
And those pamphlets answered my questions very admirably. They let me know that more than anything else, there was the problem of unconstitutional or unlawful jury selection.
Mm-hmm.
And that's called, for anyone who's kind of new to the whole jury independence movement or jury rights movement, voir dire is the process by which the judge tries to find willing conformists that will be that'll be willing to do damage to their fellow man, just on his authority, just on his encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how familiar your listeners are, or your readers are with voir dire. I mean, has that been well explained by you in the family?
No, not at all. Maybe you could explain it to us. It's spelled V-O-I-R. And then the second word is D-I-R-E, right?
Yes.
Yeah, maybe you could explain
anyway,
that to us.
Absolutely. Voir dire didn't actually exist in this country on a regular basis before the Fugitive Slave Law was passed in 1850. And as people will remember, just about 10 years before the Civil War, and that was a law that said that white Northerners had to inform on their neighbors if they suspected their neighbors of harboring a fugitive slave.
Mm-hmm.
And so even if that northerner was racist and sympathized with slavery, he could become a pariah in his community because under this law, if he actually was bound by this law by informing on his neighbors. You know, nobody likes a snitch, right?
Right.
So, and especially when the law itself is so immoral and so unjust that it's patently obvious to most people that obeying that law is very morally wrong. And so you had the abolitionists who had it all figured out. They didn't obey the law. And you had even, the fact that the law was immensely unpopular, even with people who would never consider themselves abolitionists and, who were, in fact, mainstream status quo conformists.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway, this unpopular law had wide levels of noncompliance in the North, and it quickly brought a lot of Northerners in conflict with the judicial system. And voir dire was instituted as a way of simply stacking the jury against anyone who had broken this law. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, what wound up happening was that the northern judges had realized that they could essentially just send home anyone who didn't want to apply the law against mm-hmm. their fellow man. And so it was a way of defeating the statistical favorability towards nullification.
Hmm.
Now, am I right in saying that that your readers understand something about jury nullification?
I'm sure that there'll be some people who will say they've never heard of it. So if you can just give an overview of what that means, that'd be great.
We probably earlier in the in this paper we need to this is going to be ultimately published in HTML, and I can send you those links to the ISIL papers.
Oh, cool.
Where I mentioned them earlier, mm-hmm. and people can get a username and password from ISIL, or I can send them. I can send you the the text to them, and you can republish them on your webpage.
That would be ideal.
Yeah, Larry Dodge and Don Duig wanted those pamphlets to be published and spread as far and wide as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no copyright protection on those. And those are still the best summaries of jury rights that I've ever encountered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're slightly better, in my opinion, than what is online at fija.org.
Mm-hmm.
Although that's certainly a site that your readers will want to familiarize themselves with intimately, because it's got over 500 pages of excellent information on jury rights there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just so that I can get into kind of the meat of why you would call me rather than anybody else on this subject.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are many fine activists. There's Julian Heiklin, there's Mark Schmitter, there's yourself, there's Jim Babb, there's Frank Turney in Alaska. And all of these people have actually performed jury rights activism, which is basically it's handing out pamphlets to let people know that they don't need to follow the judge's instructions and that they don't need to apply the law as it's given to them by the judge.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially, everyone, as soon as they're seated on the jury, they're instantly elevated in power above the judge. But the problem in this country is that nobody knows that. People are uneducated.
Mm.
They got government school educations, and they don't know what their power is. They don't know that it was a long, long, long battle, to get this power over the judicial system. And that, in fact, almost all of the progress that we've made towards individual freedom since the Magna Carta has simply been wrestling over power with judges and prosecutors.
Hmm.
And so what happens is that as soon as people have the right to a jury trial, that right is instantly fought by the legal system, the preceding legal system, the legal system that was in power before that.
Uh-huh.
You know, and you had the Leveller uprising in England. That was the first time that basically people had had jury rights and then had lost jury rights. And they were being tried by the Star Chamber. And then even after the Star Chamber was abolished, Moody was abolished in 38 or 48. Anyway, even so, right after the Star Chamber was abolished, they didn't just give the peasants jury rights, you know?
Yeah.
They didn't just get a right to a free, right to a fair trial. It went through this long, drawn-out period where judges would tell jurors that they were to take direction from the court, and it manifested it. The fight really wound up being over freedom of speech, and it wound up being over dissent, because the law that everyone instantly conflicted with in England in the 1640s and 1650s was the law prohibiting seditious libel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you weren't allowed to criticize the king. Okay, so, you know,
right.
In 1670, there was this, there was the most famous trial. It all kind of came to a head around the trial of William Penn.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that's the, you know, that's the famous trial of William Penn for preaching the Quaker religion on a street corner.
Right.
And he'd been locked out of the church. They had tried that, you know, so he was, you know, preaching on the street corner. He was arrested, and his jury that he was tried by contained a juror named Edward Bushell, who
mm-hmm.
was a nonconformist who thought for himself, and even though he and the other jurors were held for several days without food and without toilet facilities, Edward Bushell refused to issue refused to issue a guilty verdict. He refused
right.
to play along with the judge in that case.
I remember
and
that.
And so, for many years in the United States, even before the creation of the United States, before the Revolution even, in 1735, this was the standard that was used. This was the standard that lawyers in the colonies would use to defend people from accusations of seditious libel, because the seditious libel law didn't go away.
Mm-hmm.
Judges were just as ornery, just as opposed to individual freedom as they always have been and always probably will be. And they had tried a guy named Nicholas Bayard for seditious libel in 1731,
mm-hmm.
and they had found him guilty, and they'd had him drawn and quartered. He was tortured to death.
Oh, my gosh.
And that trial, so it was far from, you know, individual freedom was, not respected under King George III.
Hmm.
It was something that there's been the point that I'm trying to bring up here is that there's always been a battle for jury rights. There's always been a battle for individual freedom. Only 4 years later, you had John Peter Zenger, a newspaper publisher from New York,
mm-hmm.
was tried with seditious libel.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the people who quote that case forget that just 4 years earlier, Nicholas Bayard had been tortured to death, you know, for seditious libel. So it was a big deal.
Basically 800 years. I mean, this historical context that you're giving is so valuable because it puts everything in such context. I mean, we're talking about somewhere around 800 years or 900 years of fighting over this very basic thing.
The point that I really want to make clear is that a lot of people don't understand the difference between democratic checks on government power and republican checks on government power.
Mm-hmm.
And this is an important idea that doesn't really get mentioned or talked about or adequately explored in the government schools. And you can think of government power in kind of the fight against government power, the fight against illegitimate government power, as being limited by democratic limits. And the democratic limits are limits that are based on networks of brains, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so these limits, they work as an adaptive network. And the adaptive network can take a look at the situation and respond to it with intelligence. And, because it is based on the communications of network brains, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And so those democratic limits on government power tend to be very robust. And they tend to, what's known as gracefully decay.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just all on or all off. It's not just either it's enforced and popularly understood or it's completely violated. It's basically, you've got all these different levels to which a democratic limit on government power can operate and can function.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why it takes a long time for a democratic system to degrade or to decay. And, because when the judges try to yank back power from the people, the judges, legislators and politicians, of various stripes try to take power back from the people. The people can see that going on and can fight it. And it's something where it's a system that's, Kevin Kelly, the technology philosopher, says that a system mm-hmm. is anything that talks to itself.
Mm.
And and so democratic limits on government power talk to themselves. And so what are some democratic limits on government power? The most powerful one is trial by jury. Mm-hmm. Underneath that is probably democratic elections. And underneath that, you have widespread private gun ownership and the freedom of speech.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of one thing to point out here is that in the year 2000 in the United States, the case Laura Creo versus the state of Colorado,
mm-hmm.
The state of Colorado tried to just deny a woman had a right to issue a guilty verdict or a not guilty verdict. She was sitting on a jury in a drug case in Colorado, and she had personally been railroaded for a drug case years earlier, and she didn't volunteer this fact during jury selection. And I guess the judge basically just expected her to throw up all over herself and confess that she had once harbored an anti-government thought.
Mm-hmm.
And that was... she didn't do that. She kept her mouth shut, as she should have.
Yeah.
As was incredibly wise and intelligent in that situation. She pretended to be just another run-of-the-mill conformist called in to drop the hammer on their fellow citizen. And she got seated on the jury. As soon as she was seated on the jury, she was intelligent and rational enough to understand that she was superior in power to the judge in mm-hmm. terms of the outcome of the trial, and she was a holdout not guilty vote. And the judge got mad at her because she wasn't willing to send an innocent person to prison
mm-hmm.
for a victimless crime offense, and I tried to punish her for her verdict. And right away, even the defense attorneys in Colorado, now defense attorneys are not normally known in the freedom movement for their bravery. And rightfully so, because they're licensed lawyers. The whole idea of a licensed lawyer runs contrary to every idea of individual freedom that exists.
Hmm.
Because a licensed lawyer is some servile creature who's essentially dependent on the judge's blessing for his livelihood.
Hmm.
And so, the licensed lawyer and the lawyers were not licensed in this country before 1832, by the way.
Oh, really?
In 1832, you had the attempt to license lawyers in Ohio, and a lot of people call Lysander Spooner an anarchist. He was really a classical liberal thinker, Mm-hmm. And in 1832 in Ohio, he tried to, or he fought the attempt to license lawyers. They were going to say that lawyers needed a 4-year degree from a accredited school. They were going the old licensing by way of criticizing the education of your target profession.
Right.
And so it was an attempt to do that kind of very dishonest form of licensing a profession. And Spooner fought that for 4 years. And then when the state Supreme Court, or I'm sorry, the state legislature realized that he was going to be successful, they repealed their licensing law in 1836. And it went like this in every state. Not every state got licensing lawyers in 1832 and then repealed it in 1836. And then later on, one by one, though, gradually, every single state adopted some form of licensing of lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not even mandatory up until today. I believe that there are a couple of states where it's not mandatory, but the problem, even with those states, is that the judge will, any self-taught lawyer who comes into the court, the judge will basically try to make it seem as if the defendant has made a grotesque error in choosing this unlicensed lawyer, this unprofessional person to represent themselves. You've got a situation where, the judges are continually trying to wrestle power away from the people. And, up to this point, the whole process has taken, the way that I view it, it's not from the revolution that we lost our constitutional freedom.
Mm-hmm.
We've lost our freedom from the leveler uprising of the 1650s in England.
Mm-hmm.
That's where our freedom actually came from. And I was talking about the difference between the democratic limits on government power and the republican limits
right.
on government power.
Mm-hmm.
Republican limits on government power, that legal theorist, Lysander Spooner, who's popularly known as the first libertarian legal theorist, he pointed out that laws are only statements that let the government know when they can expect to encounter resistance. And I think that that's really, that's the perfect way to describe Republican limits on government power. The Republican limits on government power are say, the limits found in the Bill of Rights.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have a right to freedom of speech. But you no longer have that right today in terms of that right being considered to be a valid legal claim by the system. You know, you can say that an individual right is a legal claim.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you have a First Amendment right to free speech, but go onto a college campus with the Libertarian Party ballot access petition, and you'll find cops all around you telling you, shut up, you can't be doing that here.
Hmm.
You know, you can't be doing that here. You can go off campus onto the sidewalk where there are no people. You can't, be here in the thoroughfare, in the center of campus where you have thousands of willing students passing by and ready to sign your petition.
Mm-hmm.
The Democrats encountered this under Bush a while ago, and where they had all those laws saying that you could protest the administration out under the overpass, where all the TV cameras were absent and there were no people.
Mm-hmm.
As long as there's nobody around, you have freedom of speech.
Right.
The second that people start to pay attention, and the second that you're in a crowded area where what you say might actually make a difference, you find out exactly how much freedom of speech you have. And so that's a Republican limit on government. You've got a Fourth Amendment right to be secure in your persons, papers, and effects, basically to be secure in your private property, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, unless that private property is drugs or guns, or something else that the public can convince the majority of idiots is something that's very scary,
Or even if they just suspect.
There is no private property.
Even if they just suspect that you have, they can use that excuse on a whim say, oh, I smell
correct,
something,
correct.
You know,
and
bring
that,
the dog
that's a
over.
Great point. That's a great point, is that a lot of the people who are commonly have stormtroopers throw a flash grenade into their house and have armed men run into their house and shoot their dog or their wife or their child. You know, a lot of these people are growing vegetables, and the police then say, sorry, you know, after you've got your dead loved one, you know, in your arms. So, or your dog has been shot and you've had your eardrums blown out with a flash grenade. So, and, you know, you've got, if anybody out there in the audience is, in fact, a conformist or an agent provocateur, you know, I'll send George a link to the case of Donald Scott. And then we can also send in the link to Matt Fogg, you know, who has proven that this drug war, this alleged, you know, war against, you know, this war on private property, is actually a war against racial minorities. Because, you know, you had Matt Fogg was part of the joint DEA drug interdiction team. It was a joint DEA and U.S. Marshals drug interdiction team. It operated nationwide, and he was told not to enforce the drug laws, that they were not to run drug interdiction raids in white neighborhoods. And he's online, he's, you know, admitted this publicly, and this is a powerful tool for jury rights activists, because jury rights don't exist in an isolation chamber. They exist only to the extent that people are willing to recognize injustice and not participate in it. So, you know, jury rights are essentially dependent on the human brain, and specifically on the human conscience, okay? And what is the human conscience? The human conscience is actually, modern science tells us that the human conscience is something called mirror neurons. Mirror neurons are the neurons in our brain that, you know, form these 100 neuron pattern recognizers, and those pattern recognizers form these large areas of the brain that are just designated as mirror neurons. These mirror neurons allow us to model the pattern of someone else's experience. So if you see someone get hit by a car, your mirror neurons fire in a pattern, you know, that applies getting hit by a car to yourself. It models that in your brain. And normal people feel bad then. They actually feel bad when they see something bad happen to somebody else.
Yeah.
And there's a category of people that lack mirror neurons and that lack consciences. And those people are called sociopaths. And sociopaths, basically, if you see a sociopath kind of cringe when something, you know, when you say you and a sociopath both see something bad happen to somebody, and the sociopath kind of cringes, like he's feeling pain, he's just acting. He learned from the time that he was a child that he had to act as if he was normal in order to fit in with other people. And so he's actually in kind of a disadvantage in any kind of social situation where people don't unquestioningly look up to him as a source of authority. I think you can see where I'm going with this.
Yes.
You know, these politicians are these sociopaths, basically, politician is the ideal dream job for them. Bureaucrat is the ideal dream job for them. Have you ever encountered bureaucrats who seem like they just can't even understand why you would care if an innocent person was harmed?
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
All the time. All the time. And in fact, this is a lot of your lower level sociopaths are police. And so I understand that the conversation has kind of meandered, you know, into several different areas.
Oh, that's okay. It's interesting.
But okay, great. Well, I'm kind of trying to tie all these areas together and to give people the big picture view, because the only place that I can really give any value over those other jury rights activists that I named was perhaps in how do you respond when the police tell you that you can't be handing out pamphlets on jury rights? Because handing out pamphlets on jury rights in front of a courthouse That's a great way to get your fellow jury members, your fellow citizen jurors, your fellow, members of the jury,
mm-hmm.
to refuse to apply bad laws to good people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're trying to do here. That's what the whole goal of libertarian politics is. That's the goal of it, because that is actual individual freedom.
Mm.
And so after these previous, more than 10 years that I've been putting the Libertarian Party on the ballot, and I've had them move me from area to area, and usually move me from area to area before I can have any kind of real measurable effect,
Mm-hmm.
I come into an area, I get petitions signed, then I'm, shipped to the next place, or whatever. And it's basically continually running around, getting ballot access, running a bunch of loser candidates that then lose ballot access, and then doing the whole thing over again in a few years, is not really an effective way of actually expanding individual freedom. It would be if the candidates focused on jury rights, actually, because then their campaigns would have a variable effect. Mm. They would have this gracefully decaying level of success attached to them that could be measured.
Mm-hmm.
And
because they would influence some people, right? People
right.
would be able to do, and other people would be able to act on it.
Correct. And so you'd have network growth, which is what you're, kind of referring to. You'd grow the jury rights activist network,
mm-hmm.
and then you'd also grow jury nullification directly. You'd have some people who got seated as jurors and just listened to the candidates, and that would nullify the laws directly. And then you'd also have kind of a phenomenon that's kind of interesting. You'd have an emergent hierarchical order, start to appear, because the candidates who spoke the best about jury rights, well, those aren't going to be the sociopaths, the people who are just pretending to be libertarians or trying to access power, through the ballot.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have, the Libertarian Party has that problem as well, The sociopaths who happen to be libertarians, because a lot of people have this mistaken idea that sociopaths are all, psychopaths or low-level sociopaths like Ted Bundy or Jeffrey Dahmer,
mm-hmm.
or, some kind of killer, or some kind of really violent personality that's very easy to pick out of a crowd. Look at him, he's always starting fights,
Mm-hmm.
It's not like that. It's not even close to like that. Sociopaths are the most respected people in our society, unfortunately. They're the politicians. They're the ones who can act very well. They can really put on a good facade.
It's a shocking realization.
It is. And actually, that's the key to understanding our entire civilization right there,
mm-hmm.
is that, these people seeking power can't be trusted with it. And the Founding Fathers knew this. They didn't use the term sociopath. They used the term tyrant,
Mm-hmm.
And go ahead and read through the Federalist Papers. Read through the Anti-Federalist Papers. And, you'll see all kinds of, references that, the people who want power the most can least be trusted with it, And, this is a common sentiment.
Mm-hmm.
And, the founders were all, intimately aware of that. So
I will sum up later.
Okay, what happens when you actually start to do something that effectively fights for individual freedom,
mm-hmm.
is right away the system fights you.
Hmm.
So when I've been out in front of courthouses, right away, the judge says, it's as soon as they figure out that I'm out handing out pamphlets,
mm-hmm.
those pamphlets are little bombs, basically that are going off inside their courtroom, and it's causing chaos. In their eyes, it's chaos. In my eyes, it's expansion of the anarchic vector,
mm-hmm.
it's expansion of that domain of voluntary interaction.
Mm.
That's what I'm trying to do, because somebody smoked marijuana. They got caught by a cop. It was obvious that they were smoking marijuana, and the cop has lots of evidence that they were smoking marijuana, but the cop doesn't have any evidence that they were doing anything wrong, you know?
Right.
So, in Western law, there's the idea that there, in order for a crime to have taken place, there has to be what's called a corpus delicti, mm-hmm. okay? And that corpus delicti starts out when you're out at the party on Friday night smoking marijuana. The cop is going to come in, and he comes into the party, and he's under the common law, he's supposed to be looking for wrongdoing, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Under the common law, he's supposed to be looking for what's called a course of action. And the course of action will later become a corpus delicti when the prosecutor files charges against you.
Mm-hmm.
But in the eyes of law enforcement, that corpus delicti is what's known as a cause of action, and it has two elements, okay? The two elements of a cause of action are injury and intent to injure.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's injury to a specific known party, a specific identifiable individual or set of individuals, and intent to injure that specific known party, that specific identifiable individual or set of individuals.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you're in the party smoking marijuana, and you have no injury to yourself, and there's no intent. You're not intending to injure yourself when you're smoking marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
You're using a recreational drug, and you're going to be perfectly fine the next day. So there's neither injury or intent to injure anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's put it out this way and say, because there's arguments over whether drugs are actually damaging, and never mind alcohol, the most damaging drug of all, right?
Right.
So, for the purposes of this analysis, let's say that you just grew the marijuana, and you have a potted marijuana plant, and you showed up at the party just to drop off this potted marijuana plant to someone who is going to grow that plant because they like the smell and the look of a marijuana plant.
Mm-hmm.
And they're never going to smoke one single hit off of it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Clearly nobody's ever even intoxicated. It's a plant that grows naturally. And so there's no chance of injury then, right?
Right.
Okay. And in a normal court case, the jury would be presented with evidence then. Well, where's the intent to injure then? You can't say that any part of this marijuana plant was smoked, and you can't say that any part of it was consumed in any way. It was just there to be a potted house plant because
mm-hmm.
somebody likes it, because some American has some individual idea in their mind that they wanted to grow a plant, a forbidden plant. Okay, well, the prosecutor in such a case has no ability to prove injury or intent, and they certainly have no ability to prove intent, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because that requires the person selling the plant or the person who bought the plant freely and of their own will, that requires the satisfied customer who has no damage ever having occurred to himself in any way, shape, or form, testifying against the person who did him the favor of selling him the plant.
Right.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So there's no way for at any time the agents of the police state, the police themselves, the prosecutors, or the judges, to show that there was any wrongdoing committed.
Mm-hmm.
That cause of action, when the prosecutor gets a hold of it, is called the corpus delicti, and that's the body of the crime. And there's a thing called habeas corpus. A lot of people remember this from grade school, but they don't know what it means. They've forgotten what it means. The prosecutor has to show habeas corpus, or he has to prove, upon a writ of habeas corpus, he has to show the corpus delicti, or he has to let the person go.
Mm-hmm.
That's what habeas corpus means. Show me the body,
mm-hmm.
right? So, or produce the body, I guess so. Anyway, so he can't do that at any stage of the game. And so what the prosecutor is doing then is he's relying on the judge to come to his defense to try to help him convict the defendant. you know. Mm. And so that's the way that most court cases go. So you're handing out these jury rights pamphlets to people who are on their way into the courthouse, and you're saying to them, when you get in there, you know, with anyone who seems interested in having gotten the pamphlet,
mm-hmm.
Those are going to be your nonconformists. Those are going to be your people who don't buy into the system. And so you simply say to them, you know, to any of those people who seem to be interested, and at least until we can get a little better written pamphlet, or if you're also handing out Surviving Voir Dire, that's a pamphlet at the Fully Informed Jury Association that I can send a link to that to you as well.
Okay.
I'm sure that you're probably familiar with it, George, but in case you're not, Surviving Voir Dire is the pamphlet that and even if you have that pamphlet as well, you really don't necessarily want to hand that pamphlet out, because then that tips your hand to the judge, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It lets the judge know clearly, you know, what you're doing and what your avenue is for enlightening people.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, you're handing out the pamphlets that tell people that they have a right to vote not guilty, and that right is unimpeachable, that they, you know, that they have a right to ignore the judge's instructions, and that they have a right to refuse to apply the law as it's given to them, because that's the weasel language that they like to use.
Hmm.
And so you're handing out these pamphlets, and anytime you run into someone who might be called an early adopter or somebody who gets what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
you know, when you say, you know, you can stop, you talk to somebody for just a couple of seconds, you'll be able to figure out this. You'll be able to profile them, essentially. And I got very good at profiling people mm-hmm. from my time, you know, as a petitioner. And mm-hmm. If you encounter people who are not friends of the system and who understand what you mean when you say victimless crime offense, and you say like a traffic offense or a drug offense or a nonviolent gun offense, then oh okay, so
mm-hmm.
you've profiled someone as an early adopter, then you say. When you get in there, if you're called for jury duty, they're going to try to eliminate you from the jury if they realize that you're a nonconformist or that you can think for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say this language, all the language that I use is designed to get to the point as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm.
If people ask me what I am, I'm a jury rights activist, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because saying I'm a jury independence activist indicates that, well, you know, it's some complex idea that hasn't been defined yet. If I'm a jury rights activist, that indicates somehow I know there's this thing called the jury, and I know there's this thing called individual rights. Okay,
mm-hmm.
I've heard of the Bill of Rights. Okay, I know what rights are. I know what juries are. So there's some kind of the judges in there are trying to take rights away from the jury. Okay. If you say jury independence activism, it's language that requires a little bit more explanation to get to the same level of understanding.
Hmm.
And so I try to have my words be as pointed, as focused, and as quick to communicate valuable information as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so the most valuable information that you can communicate to someone going into a courthouse is as soon as you get in there, if you've been called for jury duty, they're going to try to eliminate you from the jury if you're capable of thinking for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why do I say if you're capable of thinking for yourself or if you're an independent thinker, whatever? You know, that's going to reach a lot of people. You know, people don't like to be viewed as stupid dupes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, I might say if you're a nonconformist or if you're capable of critical thinking, if you're capable of thinking for yourself, and I'll even use different ones of those phrases, you know, I'll profile the person's, level of how much are they an early adopter, you know, how nonconformist are they, how highly intelligently, you know, like some people are highly intelligent, they respond right away, and they say, oh, I'm glad you're out here, tell me more about this, because I think I've seen this online before, you know,
mm-hmm.
you get people like that, and it's like, oh, okay, they're already on board, they already understand, you know, roughly what's going on. And, it's very quick to turn them into absolute holdout jury members, you know, holdout not guilty votes.
Right.
And since that's what we're going for, because that's the thing that sets the defendant free, you know, that's mm-hmm. the thing that that no matter what, even if the rest of the jury is going to continue to vote guilty, you know, if you hang the jury, the prosecutor's got to order a whole other trial if he wants to have any chance of convicting a person.
Right.
And they're not even supposed to be able to do that, but they do that anyway. And that's a long conversation about, you know, double jeopardy and whatnot. So and also trying to reduce the numbers necessary for conviction, because that's another way that they have of defeating the jury. And that's just basically categorically denying that the jury exists. And, you know, like I said, that's another long conversation. But for our purposes, let's assume that they are still giving people jury trials in the area where you live.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're trying to communicate with these early adopters and nonconformists. You don't care, by the way, about all the or about all the conformists,
mm-hmm.
all of Hitler's willing executioners. You don't want to talk to those people. You don't want to waste one second of your time with them. You want to quickly find out that they're willing to do whatever the judge and prosecutor tell them to do or indicate to them through subtle cues that they should do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there are lots of people who just conform to whatever authority says or tells them to do, and you don't want to spend any time talking with those people, because statistically, there are enough nonconformists. There are enough early adopters.
Mm-hmm.
That if you only reach them, if you only get through to them, you will be able to destroy that judge's court.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you'll be able to destroy his capacity for convicting anybody of a victimless crime.
Mm-hmm.
And so, so you're just finding the nonconformists, and then you're telling them, look, as soon as you get in there, he's going to try to have you removed from the jury if you indicate in any way that you're not willing to just be his dupe and, quote-unquote, apply the law as he gives it to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the language that they use. And so just pretend to be a conformist like everybody else. Just pretend that you're a conformist, and then as soon as you're seated on the jury, just understand this. You are under no obligation to follow through with any statements or promises that you made in voir dire. You are under no obligation to unfavorably interpret those statements that were made in voir dire.
Mm-hmm.
Because in voir dire, is the jury selection process. Keep in mind, like I said, it's a holdover from the fugitive slave law. That's how they once eliminated holdout jurors from fugitive slave trials, you know, and found only the morons who were willing to send the black person back to slavery, or to send their fellow men and women, you know, their white neighbors in the North, to prison sentences, you know,
mm-hmm.
for aiding and abetting, a fugitive slave.
Mm-hmm.
And so ever since 1850 in this country, you essentially haven't had true or proper juries. And so, you know, that 1851 precedent, is the reason why we have 1.44 million victimless crime offenders in prison in this country. You know, they say that we have 2.4 million people in prison in this country, and 60% of them are victimless crime offenders.
Mm-hmm.
So that's according to the Department of Justice's own,
propaganda.
Statistics, roughly, you know, depending what you consider a victimless crime, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so people have used the Department of Justice and the FBI statistics, you know, and they've come up with those numbers. I don't know how accurate that, 1.44 million is. You know, it's 60% of 2.4 million. But regardless, and some people say it's higher than that, because they say, well, you know, people aren't considering, you know, a lot of these people calculating these numbers aren't considering tax evasion a victimless crime and whatnot, you know? So,
mm-hmm.
you know, you've got some, you know, those numbers are probably not as hard and fast and well-studied enough as what they should be.
I've heard it's as high as 80%.
Yeah, and it could be more than that. It could be basically virtually everybody, you know, except for the small number of you know, the truly violent, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you might be right about that, George. But anyway, so you're trying to find these early adopters and get them information about VR gear. And mm-hmm. then only secondarily, you know, they should be pretty open to the idea that they're superior in power to the judge as soon as they're seated. And then a lot of the time, I try to give them that extra little bit of kind of a moral shot in the arm, you know, for those people who aren't incredibly morally inclined. Mm-hmm. And keep in mind that Stanley Milgram found that 90% of people would be willing executioners, you know?
Right.
You know, Stanley Milgram is the guy who did that experiment where he put an ad in the paper that said that they needed test subjects for a psychological experiment. As soon as the alleged test subject got in there, they were standing in a room of other people that they thought were also test subjects who had answered a newspaper ad.
Mm-hmm.
But they weren't. They were all actors. All of them were actors.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were told then that they were... The teams were going to be divided up into two teams. They were going to be divided up into questioners and answerers, and they were going to try to find out whether electroshock had any effect on memory. You know,
mm-hmm.
and the people asking the questions would administer, or the scientists would ask. They would take the guy who was a questioner, and they would give him controls to provide an electroshock to the people who are answering the questions. And really, it was a study to find out, will this person give electroshocks to an innocent person?
Hmm.
And they had on the machine, and the person that they were allegedly shocking was an actor. And this person would be separated from them, you know, in another room that was really hot. And the other person couldn't tell that it was a hot room. You know, they would increase the temperature in the room so the guy would be sweating and convulsing, you know, and begging, you know, not to continue with the study, and mm-hmm. you know, the scientists would stand there saying, no, it's okay, he signed up for the study, you know, he signed up for the study, he's got to take his medicine, you know, you go ahead and shock him. And and most people will adjust the dial on the machine up to the point where it says, you know, 4,000 volts danger, you know, and even if the person's saying, I have a heart condition, I want to be out of the study, you know, people will basically shock him to death. You know, they'll risk shocking him to death and killing him just because a guy in a lab coat, a figure of authority, tells them to.
Right.
And so that experiment had been replicated, you know, hundreds of times in all different countries, as a matter of fact. There's an immense body of data about Stanley Milgram's studies, and there's a video on YouTube that summarizes all this in a beautiful presentation. Mm-hmm. by the guy who did the Stanford prison experiment. That's the one where they made two groups of students into prisoners and guards, and then without rigidly imposed limitations on what the guards could do,
mm-hmm.
they found that all the guards quickly started to horribly abuse their power, and ultimately winding up by torturing the other students, subjecting them to unsanitary conditions and stuff like that. So all the stuff you saw at Abu Ghraib, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And so this study, or this presentation on YouTube is called The Psychology of Evil. It's all that you have to, you know, type in order to get it back. And it's Philip Zimbardo. It's a speech by him. He's the author of the Stanford Prison Experiment. So they found that most people are conformists. And the other thing that's interesting, though, is that they found that if one person resists the authority,
mm-hmm.
then that 90% shrinks down to like 30%.
Mm.
So that's
leadership there, I guess.
Yeah, that is actual leadership. And see, that's the reason why I'm not really necessarily an anarcho-libertarian.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually a classical liberal, because that leadership is the kind of leadership, like everybody, all these libertarians that I know, they point to Alexander Hamilton as mm-hmm. being this big government founding father, right?
Mm-hmm.
He was the guy who introduced the seed of big government into what was otherwise a very small government constitution. Is that correct?
Right. You know, I'm familiar with that thought, and that's certainly my principal impression of him, yes.
Well, let me blow that out of the water for you, George.
Okay, please
that'll
do.
Be, that'll be a constructive result of this conversation. In 1805, do you know what Alexander Hamilton did?
Mm-mm.
He had retired to New York to private law practice, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So he was a lawyer in New York. And under the Alien and Sedition Act, people were actually being prosecuted by, these overzealous prosecutors for running afoul of the Alien and Sedition Act.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry Croswell was brought up on charges of libeling then-President Thomas Jefferson.
Mm-hmm.
So Alexander Hamilton took the case as a lawyer, and
as the defense lawyer.
As the defense lawyer.
Ah, okay.
And he took, this was his argument. I remember how I mentioned that 4 years after Nicholas Bayard was put to death for seditious libel,
mm-hmm.
You had the case of John Peter Zenger versus the Royal Governor of New York. The
right.
Royal Governor of New York was William Cosby, and newspaper publisher John Peter Zenger had published all these articles about him being a corrupt and incompetent governor,
mm-hmm.
and his defense in court was that those allegations were true, and so it wasn't seditious libel. You know, libel would be, you know, like making up allegations about someone in order to interfere with their career, right?
Right.
In order
mm-hmm.
to cause them material damage, you know, with malicious intent, you know, distributing a falsehood that then interferes with someone's ability to gain employment. And so his defense was, well, these allegations are true. This guy is a corrupt scumbag. And I have all this evidence. And the judge said, well, you can't introduce any of that evidence. And you can't use that argument in this court. You're effectively gagged from defending yourself adequately, you know, and from appealing to the common law sensibility of your common or of your fellow man. And so essentially what happened was there was an earlier lawyer named Hamilton as well. I know it gets kind of confusing. Andrew Hamilton was a Philadelphia lawyer, or a Pennsylvania lawyer anyway, who came to New York to defend John Peter Zenger.
Mm-hmm.
And against the charge of seditious libel. And in his defense, the judge was saying, you know, issuing all these contempt of court citations against him, and he just ignored the judge and prosecutor entirely. And
mm-hmm.
he only talked, he addressed the jury directly with his arguments. He
mm-hmm.
wasn't addressing the court or the public or even talking with the judge. He was just bullying forward, just proceeding forward, addressing the jury and making convincing case in impassioned language to the jury themselves.
Nice.
And the jury found John Peter Zenger not guilty,
mm-hmm.
you know, of publishing seditious libel. And so that was the case upon which our entire country really is based. Freedom of speech is based on that case. Freedom of assembly is based on that case. Freedom of the press is based on that case. You know, so
mm-hmm.
and jury nullification, the right to a proper jury trial is based on that case.
Hmm.
Keep in mind that this guy was possibly risking death, you know. Nicholas Bayard had been put to death just 4 years earlier. So that's, I mean, that was Andrew Hamilton defended John Peter Zenger in
mm-hmm.
1735.
Mm-hmm.
And then in 1805, Harry Croswell is brought up on charges of libeling President Thomas Jefferson. And Alexander Hamilton takes the case and is his defense lawyer. That case is called People Against Croswell.
Mm-hmm.
People Against, and then Croswell.
Mm-hmm.
And Hamilton, being a student of the history and being a lawyer, I used the exact same style of defense and the exact same arguments as the earlier Hamilton.
Hmm.
He addressed the jury directly. He argued in favor of nullification, and he argued that any law that was repugnant to the people wasn't a part of our constitutional republic.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting. People say that Alexander Hamilton was this big government guy, but he also believed that any law that people found repugnant shouldn't be enforced. It was null and void from its inception, as you know, the first Supreme Court case, first famous Supreme Court case, Marbury versus Madison, you know, informed everyone
mm-hmm.
that any law that's repugnant to the Republic is null and void, or Republic, I'm sorry, repugnant to the Constitution is null and void from its inception.
Mm-hmm.
And so Hamilton wanted this great big government that had no power. That had no power to enforce itself on anyone, on any innocent person. And although you might say, well, that doesn't stop there from being a central bank, right? Well, let's think about what case would have done that a couple of years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bernard von Nothaus's case.
Right.
Bernard von Nothaus challenged the central bank and was taking market share from the central bank. So if he had gotten a proper jury trial, by the way, he didn't get a proper jury trial. The mm-hmm. jury was stacked against him using voir dire,
mm-hmm.
you know? So that would have basically brought down the central bank. If Bernard von Nothaus had not been convicted, you know, if he had gotten actually a trial by a group of well-educated U.S. citizens, or even one or two well-educated citizens, and just a few additional ones who had a shred of you know, personal integrity,
mm-hmm.
you know, as soon as, you know, you're in the jury room, the smart ones can explain to the stupid and uninformed ones, then essentially there would have been a precedent saying that you don't have to obey the legal tender laws, and anybody can start a competing currency and not have to worry about brutal federal retaliation, not have to worry about armed stormtroopers coming in and seizing their computers and personal records like they did to Bernard von Nothaus.
Well, and his gold and silver as well.
Yeah, yeah, in Indiana. That's right, in 2007, in case anyone wants to look it up.
Hmm.
So anyway, you're trying to find those nonconformists, and you're trying to let them know that as soon as they get in there, the judge is going to try to eliminate them from the jury in a process called voir dire, and mm-hmm. that process is unconstitutional. And mm-hmm. so one thing that is going to happen then, if you're out in front of the courthouse giving this information to people, the judge is going to tell the bailiff or you know, some uniformed security guard now who works for the bailiff, he's going to say, hey, there's some guy out there, some jury member or prospective jury member is going to say, hey, I got this pamphlet out, you know, here from this guy in front of the court, says I don't have to listen to you, judge. And that's precisely what happened to Frank Turney in Alaska, by the way.
Oh, really?
Although the jury member, to their immense credit, were smart enough to not reveal that pamphlet until they had acquitted the victimless crime defendant. So we know of at least one documented case where the pamphlet served its full purpose, you know?
Mm-hmm.
There's a guy who was brought up on a gun charge, you know, and the jury nullified the case against him. I believe it was a felon who was possessing a gun, you know. Even though Alaska has unrestricted concealed carry of weapons, mm-hmm. anybody, you know, even teenagers can carry guns up there with no license or any kind.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, just automatically, you know, when you turn 18 off your property, and before that, if you're on private property, you know, you can be carrying a concealed weapon. If there's an average 16-year-old on private property, like let's say in a McDonald's mm-hmm. down here in Chicago, you know, they'd be thrown to the ground and, you know, beaten severely and handcuffed, you know, and taken to prison.
Right.
For something that's not considered a crime in Alaska. So it always amazes me how you cross an imaginary line on a map and suddenly you have a certain level of individual rights or individual freedom, and then you cross that line and you're in a different imaginary location on that map, and you know, no individual rights of any kind.
Yeah.
So the judge will send the bailiff out to arrest you, or I'm sorry, to threaten you with arrest. And what do you do then if you're a jury rights activist? Well, see, probably you know, more than anyone else, you know, I can go into immense detail about how disorganized we are as a freedom movement, and how unfortunate that is, because we do have people from time to time who are jury rights activists, But they have no idea how to respond when this goon comes out of the courthouse and then says, judge said you can't be doing that here. He told me to, I got to tell you to pack up and leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now you have a guy with a badge and a gun, and he's threatening you with violence. Okay?
Hmm.
He intends to do violence to you in an attempt to silence you, to shut you up, get you to leave, to stop what you're doing. And there are people there who are watching this happen. You know, there are all the bystanders standing around. And I understand that when a cop threatens you with violence, violence is the next thing that follows.
Yeah.
So what you do now is really important.
Hmm.
If you don't respond correctly, you'll be attacked by someone who's very stupid and doesn't even know what the laws are.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind. You know, that's a frightening thing, to be attacked by someone who's too stupid to understand why they're attacking you. You know? I mean, that's a situation that you find yourself in on the west side of Chicago if you're white and you're walking through a neighborhood that's enforced as being black.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because the Chicago police will, by the way, arrest you. They'll enforce racism there still, which is interesting. Liberal Democratic City, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's very, very liberal to tell me that I can't walk through a black neighborhood if I'm white. You know, this every time I go through a black neighborhood, you know.
Really?
Wait a minute, sir. You're white? You can't be here. There's only one reason for you to be here, and you know damn well what it is. You know, we're going to take you down and bust you for drugs. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's, that's strange for you to say that, you know, like, well, what if you guys were doing your jobs and there weren't drugs all over the place? enforcing separation between demographics is they've been able to successfully saddle us with, an income tax and property tax for so long.
Mm.
You know, the declaration says it's, you know, we're supposed to have consent of the governed. And, because we don't have any government by consent, you know, I didn't consent to it, you didn't consent to it, and all the victimless crime defendants, who've been sent to prison didn't consent to it, and none of the jury members who were, eliminated during voir dire consent to it. And those are the actual limits on government power. So they send out this thug who doesn't know what the law is, and he thinks he's following the law.
Mm.
So he's emboldened by that fact as well. You know, he's got power, he's got a badge, he believes he's following the law, and the judge just told him to go out there and get rid of that guy. So here you're dealing with a moron who's dangerous and violent and willing to do violence to you, and you have to quickly get him to stand down. Okay, so first of all, what I do is I say, okay, officer, you know, I'm not handing out any more pamphlets. You know, I agree to not hand out any more pamphlets.
Mm-hmm.
However, and I press the speed dial for my lawyer on my phone right there. And I, you know, and keep in mind that I'm just calling up somebody. I'm not calling up a licensed lawyer.
Uh-huh.
I'm calling up somebody who knows what the law is.
Mm-hmm.
He's a friend of mine. I'm not buying into their little call your licensed attorney thing, and the licensed attorney will roll over and piss himself in submission because he's afraid that the judge is going to have him disbarred and that then he won't be able to feed his family.
Hmm.
I'm not buying into that, you know, right off the bat. But I will say, I'm calling my lawyer, here. But I won't say that right away because I don't want him to attack me or anything like that. You know, so the order of events is this. He tells me to leave. I say, okay, I'm agreeing to not hand out any more pamphlets here. I'm not handing out any more pamphlets. I do agree to leave. And then I say, my lawyer had said that if you had come out, he'd ask if I could please have you call your watch commander.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're very polite and first you agree to obey every order that they give you,
mm-hmm.
you're taking the tension out of the situation. You don't want to be the first thing that you do to refuse, because then he just attacks you, you know?
Right.
Then you just wind up face down on the ground with handcuffs on, and then he's invested himself in violence. And so he's invested himself in trying to figure out something that you did wrong, and you already have a judge inside there who's indicated that he doesn't know what the law is either, and he's a damn judge, you know?
Mm-hmm.
He made his living off of allegedly knowing the law better than other people, right?
Mm.
And so, really, he doesn't know the law even slightly well. You know, he's just somebody who you know, in the law school, you know, in introduction to the law, he was one of those people when the instructor said, how many people here want to be, prosecutors, and the entire class raises their hand because it's easy tax money. It's an easy profession. You don't have to be intelligent in order to prosper as a prosecutor. You just have to be willing to do violence to other people, unquestioningly and mindlessly obey previous precedents, and then, the precedent was set by other sociopaths, So it's that's really the process by which it becomes a government of the sociopaths, by the sociopaths, and for the sociopaths, is in law school, And the defense attorneys are basically trained, all the precedents are all against you, and you've got to just, the only way to get your client off is to dance around, the fact and try to indicate that they didn't really break the law. And just for the record, the jury is supposed to try three things. They're supposed to determine three things. And of all three of those things, and this is since the Magna Carta, the jury is supposed to determine three things, and if all three of those things are not true, then they're supposed to issue a not guilty verdict.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? First, they're supposed to decide, is the law legitimate? Okay? And the way that you find out if the law is legitimate is the previous test that we went over. Does it have a corpus delicti?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Is there injury and attempted injury? Okay? So that's, is the law legitimate? And then the second thing is, if the law is legitimate, is it being fairly applied in this circumstance, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because the law against murder is legitimate. But what if the police only arrested Chinese people for murder, and they didn't arrest any whites or blacks, and they didn't allow Chinese people to testify? And then you say, that's some kind of crazy example, Jake. Well, no, actually, that was the case in California.
Oh, really?
In the 1800s. Yeah. There was a law that said Chinese people could not testify in court. And so essentially you could kill a Chinese person and the only other witnesses were Chinese people, and they were not allowed to testify.
Oh, wow.
So it was open racism, and that was an anti-immigrant law because there was this giant influx of Chinese railroad workers.
Mm-hmm.
They used to say there's a Chinese person under every railroad tie. You ever heard that one?
No, that's the first time for that one.
Well, that's where that saying comes from. And so here's the interesting thing, though. You had widespread nullification for this second criteria here. You had what was called political nullification because people said, yeah, this Chinese person, it looks like the evidence is against him. It looks, you've got all this evidence, even physical evidence, that he killed this other person here.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? We know that the law says Chinese people can't testify in their own defense, and he might have 10 Chinese people who are willing to say that it didn't go down the way the white witness said that it went down.
Hmm.
You know, maybe he shot this other person in self-defense.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the law against murder is still a legitimate law, right?
Hmm.
But in this case, that law, it was impossible for the laws against murder to be fairly applied against Chinese people.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So white liberals started getting seated in these cases, and the judges would instruct them that they had to apply the law. And, these people would say, yes, Your Honor, yeah, okay, we agree to apply the law. They would go through the voir dire process and pretend to be mindless conformists.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as they got seated, they would just be holed out not guilty votes. And, well, what do you mean? You know, the judge and prosecutor would say, well, the evidence is clearly against this person. You know, and, well, yeah, but the law itself, it can't be fairly applied because you have this corrupt system in place. So that's the second criteria, is the law being fairly applied, even if it is legitimate? And then the third and least important thing is, did the person actually break the law?
Mm-hmm.
Because usually the physical evidence will speak one way or the other to that. So so you got this judge inside the court, and he doesn't even know what the law is.
Mm.
He only knows the precedents that are in favor of enlarging government power. And he sent this bully up to threaten you with arrest if you don't shut up and leave.
Hmm.
So you agree to leave, and then you say, I've got my lawyer on the phone here. Now, I'm not disputing what you've told me. You know, make it very clear that you're not handing out any more pamphlets. In fact, if you're handing out pamphlets, put the pamphlets out of sight before you mention anything in your own defense. Before you even, you know, don't let the cop walk away necessarily. Don't let him think that the holding is over and done. You know, you don't want him to get the idea that he's resolved the situation and now you're going back on your word, because you have very stupid ones that kind of try to go that route, you know.
Uh-huh.
You agreed to leave and then now you lied to me. Now I'm going to beat you up. So, you say, okay, I've agreed to leave, but if you could just hold on for just another second. And that's the tone of voice and everything. The tone of voice, you're not going to see this in print, but you want to go about it in this tone of voice that says, I'm being reasonable, I'm agreeing to everything that you're saying, I just have a few questions kind of approach, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
Make it seem like you just want, you know, you just like, you know, you'd really like it if he could give you a couple of answers to your questions now that you've agreed to take his side and shut down your little jury rights activism operation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where a lot of libertarians go horribly wrong, is they're confrontational from the beginning. I have a right to free speech. I have a right. Oh, well, okay. Then they're going to get up in your face. They're going to be belligerent towards you. They might beat you down and they might arrest you. And so what you want to do is you want to have him agree to call his watch commander. The watch commander is the guy who at the end of the day has to take responsibility for what his morons in blue do. And the watch commander is also the guy, you know, like once you use the term watch commander, they're like, oh, okay, this guy knows something about something. He's done this in the past, you know? And then sometimes they'll say, I don't have a watch commander, I have a police chief, you know. Okay, whatever he says, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you say, okay, then could you call the police chief? Don't let him say, I have a supervisor. Don't let him give you someone who's not the top chain of authority.
Mm-hmm.
Because then what you're doing is you're allowing them to beat you up and have a get out of responsibility free card to hand to the judge. You know. Well, it didn't come from the watch commander. It didn't come from the police chief. Make sure that you get the police chief or the watch commander.
Uh-huh.
You know, make sure that you get someone who's in a position of actual authority, because you don't want to get beaten up. You don't want to get arrested. It's not fun.
Right.
It's happened to me in the past. Not for jury rights activism, but for petitioning to place candidates on the ballot,
mm-hmm.
which you would think is even more of a protected and respected thing of, you know,
right, it's more vanilla, you know.
Yeah, exactly. But actually, interestingly, not so. Here's the thing, the way that you proceed then. Okay, you know, officer, and always be respectful, always use their titles of nobility, even though we're not supposed to have them in this country. Officer, I've got my lawyer on the phone, and I'd like to talk with your watch commander if I could. You know, I'm not going against what you told me. As you can see, I've put the pamphlets away. I'm not handing them out to anybody, and I won't hand them out to anyone else if watch commander, you know, confirms that I can't hand them out. But but I do need to confirm that. Because, you know, my lawyer had said that this might happen, and I'd really like it, you know, you get the watch commander on the phone, okay, then you say, you know, my lawyer has told me that as per Marsh versus the state of Alabama, I have a right to hand these pamphlets out,
mm-hmm.
and that I have the right to hand them out in front of the courthouse. And that the courthouse is, in fact, considered public property as per Marsh versus the state of Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can name the Supreme Court precedent for, freedom of speech on a public sidewalk as well, if you want to, but I would recommend against it, because then you're confusing the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Just use the state precedent, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Find out what the state precedent is for free speech in the state that you're currently in. And as you can see, the last state that I had to do this in was Alabama, although it's worked in every other state that I've been in as well.
Mm-hmm.
you know, including, you know, Montana and Kentucky. And in Kentucky, we have jury rights activists now that are using, you know, this argument. And they haven't had to use the argument, really. Any time that the police have interacted with them, they basically have admitted that they have a right to be there from the beginning, you know. Mm-hmm. That, you know, in certain areas, the police are much more aware that the First Amendment is something that the general public views as not negotiable, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And in status hellholes like, you know, Philadelphia or, you know, anywhere on the East Coast, really, you know, maybe not Massachusetts. Maybe Massachusetts, you know, you wouldn't have much of a problem with this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you have Massachusetts and California are two states where they have to allow petitioners even on private property, you know.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
So actually there's kind of an excess of free speech. It almost from a libertarian perspective, the rights of the property owner are basically violated. They're forced to allow you to speak on their own property, like, mm-hmm, even if it's private property. So that's a kind of an interesting thing. Now, I mean, as far as the corporate charter goes, you know, corporations are granted additional rights, you know, over the individual. So, you know, it's kind of a back and forth wrestling over the gun kind of situation in those states. But and then in those states, you know, like in California, they'll try to say that if you record the police, you know, you're wiretapping them, you know.
Mm.
Against their permission, and then they'll try to beat you down for that reason. And that brings me to the next point here, which is always covertly record the police.
Mm-hmm.
Always covertly record the police. Always do that. Always do that.
And what's the best way to do it? What's the best tool for that, in your opinion?
There are a plethora of tiny hidden cameras that look like Bluetooth things, that look like pens. You can put that in your front pocket. And the best way, by far of all, is to have a satellite phone that streams to a satellite.
Mm-hmm.
And put Kik on the phone, that's QIK, or some other comparable program. Some of my friends like the Microsoft, the Android version of Kik better, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine too, you know. It doesn't matter. If it streams to a remote location, as soon as they punch you, that's on a satellite. They can't take it back.
Mm.
You can sue the police department then for $75,000, as recently happened here in Chicago. You know, you've got the ability then to take them to the cleaners. That's great. Do it. Do it then, you know.
Mm.
Take them to the cleaners then, you know, and make sure, I mean, so the best way, you know, is the streaming to a remote server, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And to have a tube mogul account connected to it, or a site that goes, that automatically puts the content on multiple video services.
Mm-hmm.
Because the police have the ability to take down a video on one video service. They have the ability to get YouTube to yank your video down.
Mm-hmm.
And they have the ability to track you down and prosecute you for the wiretapping as well, the alleged wiretapping charge. And if they do that, they're going to try to take the video down while they're doing it, so that you can't gain adherence to your side.
Right.
You know, so you want to make sure that you do multiple video service, so that it goes onto Vimeo, onto every video sharing site that you can get access to. Mm-hmm. You know, through like a TubeMogul.com or some other kind of service like that. And also, you know, streaming to satellites, and then going directly to the server if at all possible.
Mm-hmm.
And you also want multiple cameras. You know, you want several hidden cameras if you can. You know, the pen hidden camera that I was talking about, it goes directly onto a USB, and you just stick the USB into the side of your computer, and you've got an hour or so of high quality video.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a video that's considered very high quality by even standards that, like 5 years ago, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, you want several of these hidden cameras on your person, you know? Let them find one. Think they found it all, you know? And that's also good if you can't afford the satellite connection, you know?
Uh-huh.
At least cellular
connection, I think you mean.
Well, yeah, but I mean, sell to a, I guess that you're right, you know, in terms of that. I've only used these hidden camera sticks, you know, like the USB stick. I couldn't afford the kick program and everything, but that's technically the right way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a John Stossel special on it and everything.
Oh, really?
So, you know, yeah, you're the technical guy, George. I'm just this pauper of a petitioner who's trying to find a better line of work. But anyway, get a few of the camera, you know, USB sticks. Those work great, and usually they won't find them. The problem, though, is that if they do find them, they'll just destroy them, and then you won't have any. Then you won't have any footage, and that's. Think about it. I mean, if you're talking about the potential to sue them for knocking one of your teeth out or something, you know, for like $100,000, and then on the other hand, if they find all your USB camera sticks, you've got nothing and a broken tooth. You know,
right?
Then think carefully about which one of those you want to pick before you say that a camera phone is that goes it streams to a remote server is too expensive. You know.
Yeah. When I was arrested in Allentown, I wasn't using Quick yet. I had a handheld camera, and I had a hidden voice recorder. And I had another camera actually. They found them all, and this was after they arrested me, and they deleted the recordings on all of them. But I was able to recover with open source software the recordings, and later I even found out that they accidentally did something with the voice recorder, and they recorded themselves while they had me in a cage. And they actually talked a little bit about what they had done to me, which was entertaining. Wow. Yeah.
Well, now, I mean, can the public access these recordings? You
know, I published it all on my blog.
Yeah. Yeah, and I assume that they're on YouTube then as well?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. News to me. I'm sorry that I've been out of the loop for a while. But anyway, I'll check those out.
Yeah, I published it. I'm not sure how long ago, maybe a year or so ago. I didn't. Yeah, I shared it to I shared it to Facebook and all that stuff. But it's definitely very entertaining.
Yeah. I'll definitely check that out. Hopefully, you've got a. I've said that you don't want to use a bar licensed attorney, and generally speaking, if you can find someone who's not a bar licensed attorney, that's true. But in terms of pursuing the police state for damages, and also if you have a case that's considered winnable, you know, in the establishment as it stands, then I do think it's a good idea to pay a bar licensed attorney and have him simply go through the process that they'll recognize. I don't have any allegiance to necessarily doing things the most radical way or the most technically proper way. I have an allegiance to doing things the way that actually works and gets you the results that you want. So,
right, yeah.
Because the way that I see it is once they've basically denied that the common law exists, then it's however the common man can get justice, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, all these courts, you know, will just categorically deny that the common law even exists. Now, the Supreme Court has maintained and still does maintain that the Sixth Amendment, just like the Seventh Amendment to our Constitution, references the common law. So they're lying at some point that, you know, that set long string of precedents proves it, you know? And if you want to know whether or not, you know, the official claim is that the common law is being referenced and is being protected by our legal system, then it's easy to find out there. Mm-hmm. So at some point, somebody's just openly lying and flagrantly just ref- refusing to address an obvious truth that stands open for all to see. Mm. And this point is basically at the level of the Supreme Court. They just refused to talk about the common law.
Yeah.
They just refused to address that as the giant, you know, as the elephant in the room. And so, being that the court system is just clearly dominated by sociopaths who refuse to even acknowledge the truth, you know, if you can go through the normal legal channels with an ACLU-type defense attorney and get some kind of large damage settlement out of the police, do it, because that'll disincentivize them from beating up innocent people in the future.
Yeah.
And it'll set a precedent.
Yeah, so hey, you have laid out kind of the whole history of jury rights, which is just amazing. You know, I haven't heard that from anybody else before, and it really puts things in context. I mean, what we're fighting, you know, to avoid going back to the Star Chamber, really. And then you've talked about, you know, how powerful it can be, what it can be used, you know, keeping in mind, you know, how it can be used for us to protect each other, for good people to protect each other. And then you've talked about how to handle when, you know, a court security officer or a sheriff's deputy or whoever comes out and you know, tells you to get lost and starts to threaten you or not whatnot. But in the past, you have given me sort of a primer on how to, you know, what to do even before you get there. You know, you go to the courthouse for the first time and hand out your first pamphlet. Can you give our listeners a primer on you know, the preparation that they should do ahead of time?
Well, sure. I mean, in what regard? It's kind of setting up a complete jury rights activist movement. It's something that actually has a lot of different moving pieces to it, and it's like, in my opinion, what you want to do is you want to set yourself up for success.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to set yourself up to nullify as many cases as possible. That's the goal here. Mm-hmm. And always in your mind, it should be the innocent people in that court who you have the potential to, you know, like you're the thing that's basically their only chance for individual freedom. You know, their only chance to remain free.
Right.
And when you think about it in that regard, it's kind of interesting, actually, because a lot of libertarians are against electoral politics. You know, like the Samuel Konkin crowd and Carl Wattner crowd.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Carl Wattner version of voluntarist, which I'm a voluntarist myself, but I'm a Harry Brown voluntarist. I'm much closer to that way of thinking, which is use every tool that the system gives you, exploit every tool that the system gives you to weaken the system,
mm-hmm.
you know, and to call attention to the fact that the system itself is not legitimate. And politicians who are advocates of jury rights are a great way of doing that. Now, how does this tie in to being prepared and, mm-hmm. and setting yourself up for successful jury rights activism?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I like the idea that, I don't know if you're familiar with Friedrich Hayek or not.
You know, a little
he wrote
bit.
About something called spontaneous order.
Uh-huh, sure.
And since that time, spontaneous order that term has been mostly abandoned, and people have started to use the term emergence
mm-hmm.
to describe the same property.
Mm-hmm.
And emergence is a phenomenon associated with networks. And mm-hmm. One network is the human brain itself, and then another network is the democracy that is the result of network human brain.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can think of networks like this as having a fractal structure, a structure that's the same at any level that you zoom in on it, or not the same necessarily, but has similar characteristics in some regards at any level that you zoom into it. So if you look at one single neuron,
mm-hmm.
then that neuron is either properly functioning. It's a stupid thing, though. It's either sending a signal onward or suppressing a signal, basically, based on its inputs. So an individual neuron, you know, scientists have figured out in great detail how that individual neuron actually functions. Okay, but when you network them all together, and you have trillions of neurons, and trillions more synapses, then you have this thing that's a functional human brain. And so, you know, you could say that the thought, you know, kind of, it rises out of the connections. It emerges from the connections themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that the thinking that's going on and the patterns that are formed are emergent properties of the of a system that's connected in the way that neurons are connected to one another. And then you could say that democracy is or the intelligent actions of a democracy are an emergent property that rises out of the way that human brains are networked with one another.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I think that it's a good idea to exploit emergence anywhere that you can. And one way of doing that in terms of a political movement is that your activists, your people handing out your pamphlets, should be profiling everyone that they encounter. So when I run into a guy who's a highly intelligent guy who understands economics, you know, maybe someone like a Doug Casey or something in front of the courthouse, you know, and I check to see, does he understand what voir dire is? And, you know, is he prepared? You know, he was called for jury duty, so that's great. Does he know what his rights are? Okay, yeah, he knows what all of his rights are. He's already on the same page. And by the way, Doug Casey is on the same exact page. You know, even though he calls himself an anarchist, he's pointed out that he's a strong advocate of jury nullification and that he would attempt to get seated on the jury and to nullify, even though he says that he's an anarchist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so a lot of his other fellow anarchists place more of an importance on consistently not doing anything that the government would possibly want them to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of anarchists that I know, they say, well, if you get seated on a jury, then you're just a slave of the court, you know, you know, the proper thing to do is to get kicked off the jury, and then you're a rebel, you know, and then you're a real anarchist. Well, yeah, but then the innocent guy in court whose life is about to be ruined, you've helped the court ruin his life.
When you lost the chance to grow the Liberty Network, because, you know, someone who goes through that experience is going to be more receptive to our message.
Precisely. So it's actually about priorities, because you could make the case that, yeah, you are being more of a quote-unquote real anarchist if you don't listen to anything any judge or prosecutor ever says and don't comply and you just stay far away from all the courts. But then, of course, more innocent people will be punished.
Hmm.
And it's a cost-benefit analysis, which you'd think that a lot of these anarchists who are somewhat good at economics would actually comprehend. But at the Mises Institute, there are three very prominent anarchists, Jeff Tucker, Doug French, and Stephen Kinsella, who think that you should just get out of that courtroom let that judge and prosecutor drop the hammer on that innocent person. Hmm. Yeah. And these are, like I said, they're really popular libertarian thinkers, and they claim to have thought it through. There's a article online called "Can Jury Slaves Tell the Truth?" If you Google that, you'll get back there stupid and uninformed and callous opinions. Oh, I mean, this is just me editorializing here, but I think that it's very callous to send an innocent person to prison because you were just kind of this lazy, dilettantish, you know, person who placed their own image above 10 years of an innocent person's freedom, you know?
Right.
10 or 20 years in prison, you know?
Mm.
Like, really? You know, being cool is worth that much to you that you're just going to wreck that innocent person's life rather than sacrifice an hour, 2 hours, or let's say that it's a full day of your life. A full day of your life, let's say it's 2 weeks. Let's say that the prosecutor refuses to admit defeat and the judge refuses to admit defeat, and the jury is hung, and the judge just keeps sending you back for deliberation. And so the trial claims 2 weeks of your whole life. They didn't ever go that far.
Hmm.
They realized what was going on. They'd realize that there's a holdout juror, and the jury would be hung if the other jurors couldn't agree with you. You know, if the other jurors do agree with you, then you've got a successful acquittal, you know?
Hmm.
So those are your two chances if you're trying a victimless crime case, you know?
Hmm.
Let's say that it's the worst case scenario and it takes 2 weeks of your life and you lose your job because of it. That guy in there who you're setting free, he's potentially losing his whole life. He's losing 10 years of his life. Also, if you do things our way and you nullify, you've scored a victory for the freedom movement. You have scored a hands-down, no doubt about it, victory for individual freedom, and you've discredited the totalitarian system.
And you don't know where that can take you. You don't know how viral that could go and how many other peoples that could educate and inspire as well.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I mean, the guys from the Mises Institute, they're freedom activists for a living. They should know this, you know?
Mm.
So I mean, that might only apply to them, you know? I mean, let's say that you're a guy who, you know, works on an oil rig for a living. Well, you could lose your job, you know?
Mm.
And, you know, securing individual freedom for another person. And that's awful and terrible, you know? And, still, even so, you know, if you do that, get in touch with someone like George and let him make a viral video out of it, you know? you're precisely right. You know, is that, and by the way, here's an interesting fact.
Mm-hmm.
And this is also why I like to incorporate a knowledge of electoral politics into the activism that I'm doing in terms of jury rights activism, because there are many more ways to exploit it than just getting a jury rights activist candidate. One great thing is to have candidates for the Libertarian Party or candidates who claim to be small little libertarians,
mm-hmm.
is to insist that they go out and perform jury rights activism. Why? What possible benefit is that? You know, shouldn't they be doing candidate-like things like learning speeches and stuff? No, they should not. Because here's the thing. You're proving that they're empathic human beings.
Hmm.
If they're out in front of a court,
mm-hmm.
because sociopaths won't do that. That's an interesting thing that I found out, I think. Sociopaths won't hand out pamphlets on jury rights.
Oh,
they
really?
Won't do it. Yeah. Isn't that funny?
So it's like a litmus test.
Very much so. It's the only litmus test, in my opinion, because, you know, like I had mentioned, you know, the sociopath doesn't care about other people, and so he's going to be uncomfortable as hell handing out those pamphlets.
Hmm.
He might do it if you insist, you know, and still be a sociopath. You know, he might still pretend and everything, but it would be apparent very quickly that this guy is just going through the motions. He's just acting, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it is a great litmus test. And then here's the other thing that's interesting, is that if you actually care about other people and you prove it by defending those innocent people's freedom,
mm-hmm.
you're actually going to make a much better candidate for office. And so when I talked about emergence earlier, you're like, well, how does emergence relate to this whole thing? A leader leads from the front, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, an authority figure leads from the rear. They command from the rear.
Mm.
If you're out there handing out jury rights pamphlets, you are occupying an actual leadership position. And the only reason why you would or could occupy such a leadership position is because you're qualified to.
Mm-hmm.
Because you actually know enough to take the physical actions that other people should impersonate,
mm-hmm.
if they want to have the same effect. Now, keep in mind that that's not bossing people around. That's not commanding them.
It's setting an example.
Precisely. And that is emergent leadership. That is the emergent property of properly functioning democracy,
mm-hmm.
is that the people who are competent to disseminate a message and to defend individual freedom, rise to the task and actually directly do that. And so it benefits the Libertarian Party. It benefits the individual handing out the pamphlets. It benefits the innocent person being set free. And it benefits the general public because it lets them know what the jury actually is supposed to be. And it also benefits, if you think about it, it benefits the emergent properties of the free market, because this is only if you buy into Friedrich Hayek, which I do, incidentally. I think he was 100% right when he said this, that the market is an emergent property of the law. Okay? Because if you're an innovator and there is no law, then anybody can come along and steal your stuff. They can steal your products. They can steal your, you know, whatever. They can steal your company. You know, they can steal your personal property. And basically, there's no law there to protect you. And if there's no, and this might be where we have a difference, you know, in intellectual property. But let's say that you're an innovator. You spend 10 years inventing something that no one else can invent. And no one else can produce, and you know, you file your patent on it or whatever, then if there's no law, then you just did a bunch of free work for Pfizer or Monsanto. Thanks a bunch. We'll take it. And so they've got the big distribution apparatus. You just wasted 10 years of your life. Thank you very much. They slapped the sucker sticker on your back and bring your innovation to market. And they didn't have to do anything other than reverse engineer whatever it is you gave them. And so I think that having the courts there to prevent that sort of thing is a good thing. And that you won't enter the marketplace unless you can predictably make a profit on your innovations, on your inventions, and on your labor. If you can't predictably have your property rights protected, then you know, that work simply won't get done. That's a society that's basically crouching down and going into survival mode instead of going into overproduction, innovation, and you know, the massive explosion of wealth that was the Industrial Revolution.
You certainly make an interesting and a persuasive case. Although I think there are, you know, there are different ways of doing an intellectual property, but it certainly is, you know, as always, you have challenging things to say.
A competing idea, you know, as far as intellectual property goes, is that there is no reliable protection of intellectual property anywhere. And so you have to be in charge of distribution. You have to be smart enough to take charge of distribution, which is an additional and separate and often unrelated discipline. If you want to be a success, you know, but I think that we can also, I think that that may well be true, but if true, it's somewhat unfortunate. And in historical times in our country, when we essentially had, you know, a better shot that our individual, or that, let's say that IP would be protected and and enforced, and that if somebody, you know, brought suit against a you know, a large corporation for stealing their intellectual property, that they might win. I think that you had more innovation relative to prior existing levels of innovation. You know, so I mean, obviously, computation has driven innovation for you know, the last 20 or 30 years. You know, it's been you know, innovation has been closely correlated to Moore's law in many industries and an increasing and expanding variety of different industries. And so, you know, there's a case to be made. However, the case to be made for property rights in general, I'm not talking about intellectual property rights here, but the case to be made that predictable justice also protects basic property rights, that, like, you won't go into business if, say, the physical location where you're doing business can be confiscated or raided at any time. You see what I'm saying? Like, Bernard von Notthaus it wasn't his intellectual property that got violated when those Treasury agents, you know, busted into his operation and confiscated his computers, his customer records, and his gold and silver.
Mm-hmm.
It was his property
rights. Yeah, his basic property
exactly.
rights.
So, mm-hmm. so what I'm saying is true whether or not you mix intellectual property into it. But the whole idea is that, and this is actually interesting in terms of the fractal structure of emergence, once again, is that what our neocortex does that other animals don't have a neocortex, right? That's the portion of our brain that makes us human beings.
Mm-hmm.
And so my neocortex is talking to your neocortex right now,
mm-hmm.
essentially. Well, what your neocortex does is it makes predictions all the time. It's a prediction machine, basically. And it's making these predictions based on patterns. The patterns populate, through your senses, you know, get fed into the neocortex through your senses. You know, you've got a million neuron bandwidth on your optic nerve. And all
really?
These senses are fed, yeah, all these senses are fed into your neocortex, and your neocortex then fires back down that pattern chain. The pattern chain prunes itself and gets smaller and smaller and more general and abstract
mm-hmm.
as it goes up the pyramidal hierarchy up to your hippocampus. And then from your hippocampus, there are single ideas that are tagged with like a word or tagged with a sensation.
Mm-hmm.
And then it fires back down that chain through the six layers of the neocortex. And so this new comprehension of what is going on in the neocortex shows in the book On Intelligence by Jeff Hawkins
mm-hmm.
that your neocortex is just continually firing patterns for the purpose of making predictions.
Hmm.
And so, you know, the two blind spots in your field of vision where your optic nerve, have no information that they're sending to your brain,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it's connected to the back of your retina. Those
mm-hmm.
Those two blind spots are being filled in with likely predictions by your brain.
Interesting.
And, you know, you can find your blind spot actually by putting one of those yellow bubble blowers, you know, that kids have.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a bright yellow plastic ring on a stick.
Mm-hmm.
If you move that 15 degrees from your center of gaze, then and you keep your eyes straight forward in like a bathroom mirror,
mm-hmm.
you know, then at some point that hollow hole, you know, the bubble blower
mm-hmm.
will suddenly go ding. It'll fill in. It'll appear to be a solid yellow or, you know, whatever color, you know, that circle is because it'll be right at the edge of your blind spot, and your blind spot then will make the prediction that color just keeps on going, and it'll make that prediction at a very low level of the brain, at an unconscious level of the brain.
Mm-hmm.
And when your eyes saccade over the environment,
mm-hmm.
They move back and forth quickly. It's for the purpose of filling in the blind spots so that your brain's predictions will appear to be believable and realistic,
mm-hmm.
and you won't have this uncomfortable sensation. And so it's kind of interesting because you can say, well, okay, at the level of the human network, you know, the court system is, you know, this kind of this pattern recognizer for the intelligence that the market exhibits. You know, I find that to be a very interesting thing that essentially each individual entrepreneur makes a prediction: will the court system protect my property rights or mm-hmm. violate them?
Mm-hmm.
And so if each individual, you know, you could say that each individual entrepreneur then is acting like the 100 neuron group of pattern recognizers
mm-hmm.
that make up these much larger pattern recognizers, that make up larger pattern recognizers, and then that ultimately make up sections of the brain. You could say that entrepreneurs and the court system form that predictability function for the you know, for the court system itself and for the market itself. But that's why the market exhibits this kind of intelligence and why the market responds to competition, so quickly. And that if property rights are not protected, then you have people trying to mask what they're doing, and so you're losing all the feedback that arises from civilization.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that we should fight to protect our civilization.
Absolutely.
You know, for these reasons. And I think that the reason why we've gotten to this level where we're on the verge of creating machines that can think like human beings,
mm-hmm.
is only because it's only to the extent that property rights were protected,
mm-hmm.
that we were able to get this far, and to the extent that property rights are interfered with, we're kind of at a very dangerous margin today, because a lot of people think that the Constitution is what protects their individual rights and what protects their property rights and what gives them their high standard of living.
Mm-hmm.
And don't get me wrong, that it would be nice if all the Bill of Rights were protected and were enforced. It would be nice if that higher kind of veneer of on or off, either it's enforced or it's not enforced, protection of individual rights, the predictable standard, of individual rights that people reference, they say, well, the police have no right to come in and take my guns and violate my Second Amendment rights. Well, that's true. It would violate their Second Amendment rights, and it would be a bad thing. But there's all this focus on trying to get politicians who are actually sociopaths, who don't care and will not listen, to respect the Bill of Rights. And they will never respect the Bill of Rights. And so where the focus should be is on making judges afraid that they will be directly and immediately physically embarrassed by having the enforcement and the application of the laws thrown out in their courtroom. and that is the way to get individual freedom very quickly. If you look at the success of the Underground Railroad and the abolitionist movement,
mm-hmm.
Spiriting fugitive slaves away from slavery, getting them up to Canada or to Chicago, you look at what happens when judges deny jury verdicts, when they just flatly say, well, I don't care what the jury says, I'm going to do things my way.
Mm-hmm.
You had situations like that with Joshua Glover in Racine, Wisconsin. An angry mob tore into the jailhouse and physically set him free.
Hmm.
They, held the sheriff at gunpoint, and they said, now give us the keys. This guy is going free. We don't have any faith or confidence in your courts. Your courts have been corrupted by this fugitive slave law. And so essentially what jury rights are, is this democratic check that is highly intelligent. Each individual intelligence that sits on the jury assesses the situation for themselves. And if the jury stops being an avenue for justice, then the people respond and they say, okay, if you throw away our strongest limit on government power, then we have to go to the next democratic process, which is private gun ownership.
Mm-hmm.
We have to use physical force because you are not recognizing the law. You've thrown the law out the window. So that's why judges are afraid to just throw out jury verdicts.
Right.
Like I said, with that Creo versus Colorado case, there were defense attorneys who were saying, well, my profession is over now. There's only violent rebellion in the future. When you have mainstream conformists who are licensed by the government to practice their line of work saying things like that, that's a strong signal, to the government that they've gone too far. They've made a mistake. They have to try to reverse that mistake and find some way of saving face.
Yeah.
And
hey,
so
and that is a great point to wrap this up on. Even though I'm having conversations with you are so inspirational because you draw on such a wide range of different disciplines, and you bring together history and morality and strategy, and it's just amazing. So we're going to have to do another call again soon, Jake. But before we end it, is there anything, any projects of yours or perhaps your favorite project of someone else that you would like to plug before we wrap it up?
Gosh,
aren't you writing a book?
That's it. You know, I've got my book about halfway done, and I ran out of money to keep on footnoting it, so I don't have any money to finish my book. But I can't very well publish it and have half the footnotes, left out, because then I'll just look like I'm an idiot and I haven't read all these other things. Which, by the way, the information from the history of jury rights that I was mentioning. Mm-hmm. is from Larry Dodge and Don Duig. And then the other great work on the subject is Jury Nullification, The Evolution of a Doctrine by mm-hmm. Clay Conrad.
Yeah, I actually have That's this book here, book. And I'm about a third of the way through it. And I'm actually interviewing Clay in a few days as part of this series.
Yeah, that's outstanding. Clay is the recognized expert. Nothing that I've said from the history or any of the legal precedents or anything, I mean, it's all in that book. Clay uncovered it. Clay is a... is a licensed attorney, and he's also a self-taught lawyer. Mm-hmm. So he's an attorney who went beyond the what was required of him, and actually gave himself a proper education, a real education on the subject, using mm-hmm. the Houston Law Library. And so, I haven't innovated a single thing in terms of knowing what the history is in this.
Well, you're able to speak about it intelligently. Don't sell yourself short.
I'm able to tie it in maybe to a couple of other different disciplines. In terms of public outreach, I know something about that because I've done it for the last 10 years, and I've seen where and how it fails, and why it repeatedly fails, even though it's a strong strategy.
Mm-hmm.
And, so I've identified a lot of the failure points and a lot of the alternatives, but, Clay Conrad's book is great, and then Jeffrey Abramson's book, We the Jury,
mm-hmm.
is another book that contains some of the information that's not in Jury Nullification, The Evolution of a Doctrine,
mm-hmm.
and it's missing some of the information that's in Jury Nullification, The Evolution of a Doctrine. So both of those books are excellent books to get. And then the other book, and this is the one that focuses more on political nullification, like I said in the example of the Chinese rail workers.
Sure.
And immigrants in from the Chinese immigrants in California, the California law actually, and it also focuses on the drug war's impact on Mexicans and blacks in this country,
mm-hmm.
and the extreme racism of the drug war, and political nullification in terms of being the proper response to that is. Paul Butler's book, Let's Get Free, A Hip-Hop Theory of Justice by Professor Paul Butler.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you had those three books, you'd have all of the historical and legal information that I've given you tonight. And then the other thing, like I said, the two pamphlets from the Society for Individual Liberty
mm-hmm.
are still, and I haven't found them on the FIJA.org website. Mm-hmm. I believe they're only online at ISIL.org. And so I found those when I was at the, when I first started working for the Libertarian Party. There were all these ISIL.org pamphlets around.
Mm-hmm.
Since I had been a child, I had always in the back of my mind said, if they can't keep other people, if they're going to call other people, then I can look like those other people and I can get seated on a jury and I could just say not guilty. If it's any kind of a drug offense, that was apparent to me as a child,
mm-hmm.
And I always wanted to know, how is it then? Like, are all these other people in society, am I just like one in a thousand? Is the kind of person that I am so rare that juries just act mindlessly, and get controlled by the judge? And then I realized, oh no, there are all these other things that they do. To try to stack the jury against the defendant and to try to silence the defendant and, to shut the defense attorney up and not let him actually use proper defenses.
Hmm.
And so those two pamphlets that basically said, hey kid, you were right, you know? Like, I mean, that was a thing that mostly just because that was the essence of the pamphlets, that basically said, yeah, you were right, and by the way, there's a giant society of these people out here who also hate the government and hate what it's doing and don't want to cooperate with it, and who have identified the jury as the weak link in that in the chain of tyranny.
Mm.
You know, that was just a good experience for me to have. So I do owe the Libertarian Party that, you know.
Yeah. Well, hey, Jake, it has been really great, and, you know, we haven't talked on the phone very much. It's only been, this might only be the second time, actually, This has been really great, and I know that this resource, the recording of our phone call, is going to be so very useful, you know, to people who are first hearing about this issue. So, Jake, I really want to thank you for this.
Yeah, I was kind of hoping, actually, that you wouldn't put the recording out there, because I kind of stumbled and embarrassed myself.
Are you kidding? This is golden. This is golden.
So many portions of the conversation. It wasn't exactly a polished speech at all.
Well, that's how interviews roll. They're off the cuff. They're authentic. They're genuine. So
yeah, it was a little too rambling in some portions of it, though. But
it was all useful.
Anyway, good luck, and I guess. Just they're hearing me say this now too. So, but anyway, that's great though. And you know, George, just getting all the information out there and getting people organized and, you know, getting them confident enough. I really wish that we could have maybe spent a lot more time actually on what needs to be done to prepare an activist, and also to prepare an activist structure so that it's resilient. Because there are certain
things.
That's
a great topic. We should do another call soon. Then I'll hit you up with an email and we'll schedule something.
Maybe so. And in that, you can kind of as a part of that topic, you know, it'll be important for people to recognize that the state is very predictable. Just like I said, every judge, anytime I've been in front of a courthouse, they have come out and threatened me.
Mm-hmm.
And if I had no resilience and no spirit and no awareness of my ability to defeat that police officer, you know, by calling his watch commander and stating that the First Amendment precedent on the record, there's a very specific reason that you do that, because you want to force the watch commander to acknowledge the precedent, because here's what they'll do if you don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
They'll actually arrest you, violate all of your rights, and you'll sue them for beating you up with no right to do so. And then they'll say, well, our officer out there didn't know what his job was. They'll actually say this. They didn't know. He didn't know what the First Amendment precedent in this state was. The judge told him to do that, so he assumed that he just didn't know the proper First Amendment, that he didn't know that the First Amendment didn't apply on courthouse steps, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And he assumed that. So he was just following orders mindlessly, and it's essentially the variant of the Nuremberg defense.
Mm-hmm.
And so he came out and violated your rights, but he didn't know what the law actually said. So, oops, sorry, we made a mistake, but you can't sue the department now that every cop in the department has been informed that people have a right to be in front of the courthouse. That's what will happen. That has happened in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Is that they simply deny it. They say, well, we didn't know what the law was. Now, keep in mind, it's their job to know what the law is, right?
Right.
They're out there enforcing the law. But that'll be their get-out-of-jail-free card. Is, oops, we made a mistake. Real sorry. And now, good luck getting your dental work completed. You know, you shouldn't have, quote-unquote, mouthed off to that cop.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you get it on the record, you get the watch commander saying it, you know, you get a recording of it on your satellite phone, you know, then they have to allow you to stay. They can't attack you. They've already acknowledged on a recording what the precedent is.
Mm-hmm.
So you've taken that argument away from them if you wind up in court testifying against them. So that's why I do that. You know, like,
mm-hmm.
there are all these things. And see, the average guy, all across the country, I've run into jury rights activists who, when the cop came out. They packed up their stuff and they left. They said, I can't afford to get arrested. I don't know what this guy is going to do. I don't know what the First Amendment precedent in my state is. But he's a scary cop. He's threatening me with physical force. I'm just going to leave. Hmm. And time and time again, the freedom movement has to overcome that problem. Like, oh, really? You left? No. Here's what you should have done, you know?
Hmm.
And so we can't keep activists in front of the courthouse. Moreover, we don't even know which courthouses are the worst offenders. The prosecutors and judges know. They have detailed records. They know exactly how many malaprohibita offenses they prosecuted. Mm-hmm. You know, they have that information. It's all digital. It's electronic data that they have. If you want the data, it's really funny. The circuit court in Chicago, you know, there are five districts in the Cook County Court, and I've tried to get this digital data from them, and there was a bureaucrat who was in charge of records for, let me see, I'm looking at here, District 5, the Cook County Courthouse at, it's 708-974-6404 is the guy's phone number, extension 6501. He actually said, we can put the information down a hole if we want to. And I said, well, this information is publicly available to people who go to the courthouse in person to look at the computer screen. And he said, yeah, it is. But we don't have to give it to you in a usable format, you know?
Hmm.
So essentially, the freedom movement is always at an informational disadvantage. And right now, the freedom movement isn't even, you know, even the Fully Informed Jury Association, they're not even focused informationally on changing the informational picture and giving activists the same information that the prosecutors have. So there are all these different areas where we could basically get orders of magnitude more efficiency out of our process, and these are orders of magnitude that the other side is already exploiting, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And they're at a much more sophisticated level than we are. I mean, I think I've identified all these things at very least. I don't know anyone else who has, you know? So I mean, maybe at this point, I've seen very smart remarks from Clay Conrad online, on Facebook, and he's aware of these things clearly from the things that he's saying, but I don't even think, like, he doesn't really even cover those things in the book because he's not really activism focused. He's more focused on, as long as you know what the facts are, and you know what to do. You know, you, the reader of his book, then that solves the problem for you. You know, like, you're not a part of tyranny anymore.
Right.
And that's good, but what I would like to see is an organized response to tyranny in such a way that we had a strategy that had a beginning, a middle, and an end, and that at the end of our strategy, the police state is powerless.
Mm-hmm.
And we have something resembling a new industrial revolution, and some people, you might hear them refer to it as a benevolent singularity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, singularity is the idea that, we get to a certain level of technological achievement, and we basically achieve complete control over matter because we have strong nanotechnology.
Right, yeah,
and
I'm familiar.
So I think you are a future.
Well, actually, you informed me about it a little bit. But hey, let's wrap up this call and let's schedule another one to talk about those topics you mentioned, because this really is important stuff. Thanks, Jake Witmer, an incredibly bright guy with a ton of experience here, a lot of information to share. Jake, thanks so much and have a great day.
I appreciate that, George. And if you're working for the CIA out there, keep doing the great job. We think what you're doing is just wonderful.